You know that moment in Voyager when Tom Paris walks onto the bridge and Chakotay gives him shtick for being 20 seconds late for his shift, and then Tom goes to the helm to find a little box with a single pip inside it sitting on his chair, and he's promoted back to Lieutenant Junior Grade and everyone has a giggle about it? I didn't get that moment. There was a whoopee cushion with a pip in it. Yes, my lords, ladies and sovereigns, it finally happened. Captain Jack has promoted me, at long last, to Lieutenant Adam. Will he and Editor Wizard Troy forgive me for pausing for a fanfare? Yay! And or boo! But that's enough self-aggrandizement there. I'm already looking too Cardassian for my own good. Let's go ahead and get straight into it. There's an organization which creeps beneath the surface of Starfleet and the Federation. And in order to carry out their covert missions, they need ships. That's why, kids, today we are looking into one of my favorite things in all of the Trek universes, Section 31, and of course, their many starships. If this is your first time here, welcome to Trek Central. I'm your host, Lieutenant Adam, and let's get into a new ship breakdown video. If you want to keep up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure to hit that subscribe button and never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media for daily updates on the Star Trek universe. Section 31 has been a part of the Star Trek universe since they were first introduced in Deep Space Nine. In my humble opinion, the best of the many Trek series. Recent projects in the Star Trek universe, both the Kelvin movies and Star Trek Discovery, have added to the tapestry of this elusive organization, and along with the expanded lore, they've brought a bounty of stealthy ships. In this video, we break down the many vessels you see in this secret fleet, what they're about, and the battles they served in, as well as some behind-the-scenes info on what went into designing the dark reflection of Starfleet ships. Let's start with the Section 31 ships of the Prime Timeline. During the mid-23rd century, Section 31 was considered to be an important part of Starfleet intelligence, and was officially sanctioned, working more akin to the Romulan Tal Shiar, or the Cardassian Obsidian Order. Section 31 ships that were active during the 23rd century were specifically constructed to support its organization's covert operations. The hulls of Section 31 ships were a darker color compared to other Federation starships at the time. These starship classes also deviated from traditional Federation starship design that was so well known within the 23rd. The NCIA 9-3 type starship was one such ship class employed by Section 31. The vessel was 274 meters in length, and instead of a saucer section attached to the nacelles, the primary hull was triangular, which was a theme consistent with Doritos, Section 31's fleet of this era. Sorry, I'm hungry. Not only did the exterior deviate from Starfleet ship design norms, but the interior did as well, with the ship's bridge being two stories and not featuring the usual captain's chair format consistent with Starfleet ships. The ship was able to mask its warp signature, which aided in its covert operations, as well as retracting its nacelles when not at warp, with this mode being referred to as dark mode. Presumably, this aided the ship in running dark and avoiding detection during covert operations, such as when Captain Leland's NCIA 9-3 type starship was operating in Klingon space, following the Federation-Klingon War. The retractable nacelles of the NCIA 9-3 type would serve a further purpose, with minimizing the silhouette of the ship from sensor sweeps, and also so its closed-up look would not look Federation compared to the nacelles out. So if the ship was found in its dark mode, its design would not give away that it was a Federation starship. Section 31 was an advanced organization technologically compared to the rest of Starfleet and the Federation, and their ships were an example of this. Ships of this type had the ability to holographically alter their outer appearance by disguising themselves as another object, such as an asteroid. This was similar to the Romulan drone ship seen during the 22nd century, which used multispectral emitters. It's not a stretch of reason to say those could have been recovered from the wreckage of those drone ships a century prior and refined. This theory would actually make sense. As we know, Section 31 were operating during the NX-01 Enterprise's conflict with the Romulan drone ships. Their ships were also equipped with tractor rigs, a piece of technology which enhanced a ship's tractor beam strength by tethering the tractor beams to probes that could be attached to other objects. The ship's operating system was also highly advanced for its time, being more consistent with the Elkar's design of the 24th century, instead of the typical I've dropped a bunch of light-up dice all over the Starfleet computer design used during the 23rd century. Another class of starship used by Section 31 was, of course, the Nimrod class. This vessel was 872 meters in length, and like the NCIA 93 type starship's primary hull, it was triangular, with a cutout in the middle and a much larger secondary hull underneath the saucer. The ship utilized four nacelles. Whether these nacelles could fold like the NCIA 93 type, or whether the ship could also go into a dark mode, is unknown. One thing which differentiated the Nimrod class from the NCIA 93, other than its size and design, was that the Nimrod class carried hundreds of small drones that could be operated remotely. During normal operations, these drones were docked to the saucer section of the ship, and when launched, the framework on the primary hull became an open lattice. Another four nacelle ship class in Section 31's fleet was known as the Huyi class, possibly named after the mythological Chinese archer. Instead of the four nacelles being behind the primary hull like in the Nimrod class, the nacelles strutted off the ventral and dorsal side of the primary hull of the ship, and above the primary hull was a roll bar-like structure similar to the Miranda class. Also with a similar structure to the Miranda class, there were two nacelle ships used by Section 31, with a larger version known as the Deimos class, and the smaller version as the Shiva class. All these other ships also had drones docked into the framework of their primary hull. So what's the deal with all the drones anyway? Well, the drones docked into the Section 31 vessels came equipped with an armament of phasers, comparable to the phasers used by Class C shuttles, as well as utilizing refracted lattice shields for defense, which were strong shields, but left them vulnerable when targeted from the port and starboard directions simultaneously. The drones were the size of one-man fighters, and as they were unmanned, they could be used in kamikaze-style combat. I just hope that Section 31 didn't take a leaf out of Tony Stark's book and leave their entire fleet of drone ships to be controlled by a single pair of really crappy sunglasses. All Section 31 vessels previously described were present during the Red Angel incident of 2257, with the main ship being the NCIA 93 under the command of Captain Leland, who initially helped the USS Discovery in finding Spock and the Red Angel. Unfortunately, however, Leland and his ship both fell under the control of a rogue AI known as Control, and that is far worse than any crappy sunglasses. Not only Leland, but the entirety of the Section 31 fleet would also fall under the influence of Control, with this fleet fighting a major battle near the planet of Zaheer. Control and its new fleet fought against the combined forces of Starfleet, the Klingon Empire, and the newly liberated Kelpians. Control was completely defeated during this battle, with Section 31 being officially shut down following the incident. But of course, that was nonsense. It was absolutely kept alive through its new head, Ash Tyler. What happened to the NCIA 93 type starship or any of the other Section 31 vessels after this point is unknown. Whether it was used by the new Section 31 or not, well, that's also unknown. Look, it's best if you just remember that whenever we're dealing with Section 31, the phrase "that's also unknown" features prominently. Perhaps the lore explanation reason for these Section 31 ships being absent by the time of Deep Space Nine is that Section 31 as an organization moved further back into the shadows, given it was officially shut down after all. That would make logical sense in the grand scheme of things. What about behind the scenes? Well, the Section 31 ships were designed by Star Trek Discovery Season 2 lead ship designer Ryan Denning, who had taken over from the legendary Trek ship designer John Eaves, who worked on Season 1 and had moved over to Star Trek Picard by that point. The intention of the NCIA 93 type ship was for a stealth ship that operates in the shadows, and could practically look like it could hide from other ships. An inspiration for this stealth design also came from one of my personal favorite aircraft in the whole wide world,
the Lockheed SR-71 Blackbird, an advanced long-range strategic reconnaissance aircraft capable of Mach 3 and an altitude of 85,000 feet.
The F-117A Nighthawk, commonly known as the Stealth Fighter, with its angular design, which you can see in the design of the NCIA 93 and the other ships of the fleet, was also meant to set them apart from other Federation ship designs, but still retains something that lets you know it's a Federation ship, that being its nacelle configuration. From the very beginning, the intention of the Battle of Zaheer was to include drones in the battle, so the design of the other Section 31 ships was to be motherships for these drone fighters. But anyway, let's move along to the Calvin timeline, shall we? Yes. Now, Section 31 existed in that timeline as well, given that the timeline split did not occur until the 23rd century, so naturally we can explore what starships fit into the timeline even more. Of course, the most famous and only Section 31 ship we see in canon in the Kelvin timeline is the dreadnought USS Vengeance. The Vengeance was built at the Io facility around the Jovian moon of the same name, which in my humble opinion, despite being a secret Section 31 shipbuilding facility, had really, really crap perimeter security. No, you explain how Scotty was not caught floating in front of the main dock entrance in a shuttlecraft all that time! The Vengeance was launched in the year 2259, and the class was described as having two times the size of the Kelvin USS Enterprise, three times its speed. That would make the vessel around 1,300 meters long, and able to reach warp 12 with its advanced warp capabilities known as Mark IV capabilities. The ship utilized a darker hull than that used by the Starfleet of the Kelvin timeline, but still had similar elements in its design, with a primary saucer section attached to a secondary hull and two nacelles. The Vengeance was equipped with an array of advanced phasers that arced toward a target, seemingly with a tracking system, and phaser hits could penetrate through the shields and cause major hull breaches to even the flagship of the Federation at the time, that being the Enterprise, of course. The vessel also had Type 7 phaser drones and swivel-mounted photon torpedo launchers that could be deployed from the dorsal side of the saucer section from beneath the hull, which could rotate and launch torpedoes at various firing arcs of the ship. And I was today years old when I learned that. I always thought they were railguns. Man, being a lieutenant is opening up so many windows for me. Anyway, moving on. Now, this ship was clearly heavily armed and used several experimental technologies, which included stealth technology, believe it or not. Now, that may not have been as good as a Romulan cloaking device, but it still made the ship incredibly hard to detect. Quite an achievement, considering the thing was the size of a small moon. The Dreadnought class utilized highly advanced AI to reduce the amount of crew needed to operate the vessel, with the vessel theoretically allowing a single officer to operate the ship. Engineering was designed so that it could be run automatically, with the only crew needed to be on the bridge of the vessel. The transporter system of the Vengeance was advanced as well, allowing site-to-site transport of multiple entities at the same time, which meant the transport of 72 objects at one time in this particular situation. Likewise, the sensors of the vessel were also advanced, with multidimensional radar and space region observer systems. The deflector could be covered while the ship was not at warp, to presumably protect it from damage during combat, and the ship's hull was also extremely durable. It stayed intact even after the detonation of 72 photon torpedoes inside the vessel. I do find it weird, though, that an extremely largely automated and minimalist crew-staffed ship had so many damned hangars, with Hangar 7 of the ship being located on Deck 13. Which meant it had at least six others. Seems a bit excessive if you ask me. But again, moving on. The Vengeance was launched in the year 2259, and it was captained by Admiral Alexander Robocop, Marcus, the then head of Starfleet and the head of Section 31. And it was designed by the Kelvin Universe version of Khan Noonien Singh, a eugenically augmented superhuman from Earth's eugenics period in the late 20th century. Interestingly enough, Admiral Marcus had a model of the super-secret ship in his office. I wonder how he explained that to people who visited him and asked him what the heck it was. What? Oh, that? Oh, that's just a thing I got off Wish.com. The listing said it was a Constitution class. I'm just glad it wasn't a hot dog van. Anyway, Marcus used the Vengeance to catch up to the USS Enterprise, who had captured Khan, and was going to expose Marcus's plans to start a war with the Klingon Empire. Khan would take command of the Vengeance after killing Marcus and attempted to destroy the Enterprise, but was ultimately disabled upon beaming an arsenal of 72 torpedoes, believing them to store his fellow augmented brothers and sisters. The disabled Vengeance would then crash into San Francisco on Earth, leveling the city in its path. Khan would be defeated by Commander Spock of the Enterprise and put into stasis. Well, the intention of the Vengeance was also to look like a dark reflection of the Enterprise, and went through numerous designs, being conceptualized as an angular black-hulled Leviathan. In some designs, the saucer had way more cutouts in it, almost being like a crescent shape instead of a saucer. The design went through numerous iterations over many months, but other than the main hull changing design a lot, one of the biggest changes was the bridge of the Vengeance. Some of the original designs for the bridge were very different from the conventional bridge layouts of Starfleet vessels. We had multi-leveled bridges similar to that seen in Discovery's Section 31 ship bridges, but with more central elevation to keep the captain of the vessel above everyone else. The Vengeance was meant to be a dark enterprise. It was decided that the bridge should also reflect that, and it was instead tuned to be a dark reflection of the USS Enterprise bridge. The Vengeance also had a lot of unseen weaponry, the team at ILM going just a little too bonkers for what was needed for the film. There were 8 to 12 different kinds of weapon systems. One were the phaser drones, which can be seen on the Vengeance model next to the deflector dish, but were intended to detach from the vessel like drones and fire phaser beams in a 360-degree arc. As the Vengeance was also the first ship seen in the employ of Section 31, it's no surprise that it was looked at for inspiration when designing the Section 31 ships of Discovery, with the main takeaway being its darker hull color, which helped to sell that these were ships for a more morally gray organization than that of Starfleet. So before we round off the video, let's take a small look at the Section 31 ships in the Kelvin timeline from the comics. Now, the first we'll need to get out of the way, of course, is the USS Vanguard. Now, that was simply just a Miranda-style Kelvin ship, utilized by Section 31, so we won't really talk about it. However, the other vessels are very interesting. Well, first, we have a USS Kelvin-style Section 31 ship, which was seen in the Star Trek ongoing comic series. These vessels, as said, bear a resemblance to the Kelvin-type starship, with a saucer section, which in this case is more like a crescent section, and a dorsal and ventral nacelle. Whether these two sections are both nacelles or one is a secondary hull like the Kelvin is unknown. Big surprise, I know. These ships employed some form of stealth technology, which allowed the ships to move undetected by a fleet of Romulan ships. Whether this was a dark mode, similar to the dark mode used by the NCIA 93 type from Discovery, or a form of cloaking, is unknown. And finally, we see a Section 31 ship which actually has stealth technology. This four-nacelle ship is hardly seen in other than a few panels, but its saucer section has even more cutouts than previous ships we have seen. At this point, why even bother with the saucer in the first place? This vessel appeared to a fleet of Romulan ships, and it was able to destroy the entire fleet, thanks to code embedded in the Romulan systems because of the sharing of the dorsal-mounted weaponry seen on the USS Vengeance that Section 31 had shared with the Romulans to help them wipe out the Klingon Empire. And that, my friends, was all the vessels seen in employment by Section 31, the mysterious organization hiding beneath the pristine Federation, from its Kelvin variant to its Prime variant, in all of its unknown glory. Let us know what you think of the video in the comments below, because if you're talking about Star Trek, then we want to hear about it. And if you want to keep up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure you hit that subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media or join our community Discord server. For now, I've been Lieutenant Adam. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time. Live long and prosper, my friends.